experienced the presence of the Lord in ways you have not yet experienced. It's all through the scripture. And you know, he's had us on a journey. We started just looking at the kingdom, and we've gone through the study of gates, and we've looked at where all the places God wants us to understand our authority. But in the midst of it all, it still comes back to this simple truth. In every way, he's always leading us to himself. To experience.
I want to give you an understanding.
The glory of God, when it comes, it usually would come, and we'll see this in Scripture, as a cloud or as fire. And in many cases, I remember Miss Linda last week told of seeing the glory. You know, they were at a Marcelo crusade, and the glory was as a cloud was coming through, or smoke coming through all of the entrances. And it came, and it just came upon Pastor Marcelo until he glowed. So, I mean, it's amazing when God chooses to release His glory and to reveal it and it to be manifested so that you could see it, touch it, and feel it. Now, how many of y'all have ever heard the word Shekinah glory?
Yes.
Okay. Have you thought that the Shekinah glory was a description of the glory itself? You thought that's what it was? You thought that Shekinah was maybe a higher level of glory than regular glory? I just want to tell you something. Glory, the glory of God does not come in levels. When you touch His glory, you touch all of His glory. Shekinah does not describe the glory. It tells you what it does.
Amen.
And I'll show you the scripture, but it's the Hebrew word shekan, I think is how you would say it, for Shekinah. It means He takes up residence. He comes and dwells. He abides. Again, I'll show you this in a minute. Okay. At the Azusa Street Revival, that what set, and this is what the Holy Spirit was saying, what set them apart was the fact that the glory came and stayed 24-7 for 3.5 years. Never left. In fact, the building couldn't contain it. People would be walking down the street 2-3 blocks away, and all of a sudden would be overcome by the glory of God, would fall on the ground and come up speaking in tongues and not even knowing what was going on. They would come running to this revival. And even half a mile away, there was a young man by the name of David Garcia, one of your relatives. I'm sure. A young member of Azusa Street. He would walk past LA's Grand Central Station, their train station there in LA, on the way to Azusa Street. And what he saw caused him such alarm that he comes running and he gets one of the men, the leaders at Azusa Street, said, "Come, you gotta see this." And so they go running back to Grand Central Station, and there's the people are getting off the trains from all realms of all countries. They're falling out in the Spirit and coming up speaking in tongues. I mean, just the move of God. And so they went there and had a revival in Grand Central Station. I mean, the glory of God is such a powerful thing when it happens. It's powerful in Scripture. It's powerful in life. But when it starts happening, miracles, beyond anything you can imagine. In Azusa Street, those 3.5 years, and it didn't just happen with William Seymour, though it happened a lot with him, who was the pastor, who was leading this. But it happened, many of these were teenage boys and girls. Many of them were teenage boys and girls who grew, teenage boys like John G. Lake, like F.F. Bosworth, like C.W. Ward, who started the Assemblies of God, or founded it. These were teenagers running loose and they're laying hands on people and seeing people heal. People of arms that had been severed in industrial accidents grow completely out. Men coming in with a wood leg, a leg completely grew out. Hands, teeth, eyes. A couple of them, just a quick pictures of just to give you, I thought it was so amazing. One woman in her 20s, came and she had a huge growth on the side of her face. She said it was the size of a basketball. She was embarrassed to be out because people would gawk at her. And she thought, my last chance, I've got to get to Azusa Street. All I know is miracles are happening there. I hear the stories, and I've got to get there. And she has to hold this thing up with her hand. And she's standing out in front, and she said, oh, God, do I dare go in? She said, I'm looking at the building, and there's fire coming down from heaven, fire coming up from the building and meeting it. She thought, if I go in there, I'm going to die. And she said, but if I stay out here, I'm going to die. And she goes in, and instantly people see her and come running to her and says, you know, God's going to heal them. It's going to be gone. And she says, all I thought was, I hope that's true, because I can't keep doing that. It was so big and so intrusive in her head, they couldn't do anything about it. Within moments, it was completely gone. And she was totally gone. Another one that was just touched me. This lady in her 80s was dying of lung cancer to the point that she could barely breathe. She lived 2 miles from Azusa Street, and the picture is this: that she started walking, and this is how she would walk, kind of dragging her feet, inches at a time. It took her 3 hours. To walk from her house to Azusa Street. And she came in and said, you want a miracle? She said, listen, if I don't get my miracle today, I'll be dead in the morning. She said, God's my only hope. I'm here. And she was 5'8", weighed 65 pounds. They said, just skin and bones. Like death itself. And so she comes in, they pray for her. She's totally healed. I mean, her lungs are free. And she's praising God, and she sits there in the cloud of glory. Now, they described it as being so thick that you would want to reach out and grab it. I mean, you could think you could hold it. It's such the heaviness of it throughout the place. And she sat there, and she gained 40 pounds that evening. Just for being in the glory. Is that not amazing? She goes to her doctor the next day, and he wants to make her fill out a new patient form. He didn't recognize her. He did all the checks, and he said, look, you're so new on the inside, there's nothing wrong with you. He was so touched by it. In fact, he said, you've been going down to that warehouse. LA was talking about it. It was in the paper. I mean, because of what was happening then. I mean, you think in terms of the glory all day long. People were being healed literally hundreds a day. The teacher brought 35 dead children from her school. And she comes in, and one of these teenage boys walks up to her and said, so, you don't want a job? And she looks at him and said, you don't think they're all going to get healed, do you? And he said, of course. And so he told him to grab what he got him to hold hands. And he just went up to one and he began to whisper into his ear. He said, say, praise God. And in just a moment he said, praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah. I can hear. Praise God. And one by one, without praying for them, they would start, I can hear that. I can hear that. I can hear that. All 35 of you. Just get there. What the Holy Spirit was saying to me, he said, now this is a picture of what I'm going to do. Okay, let's just talk a minute about the glory. Go with me 2 Corinthians 3, 6 through 11. 2 Corinthians 3, 6 through 11. Just beginning. And he also made us confident as servants of the new covenant, not of the letter, but of the Spirit. For the letter kills, but the broker of the Spirit gives life. Verse 7. Now, if the ministry of death carved in letters on stone came with such glory that
children of Israel.
And the children of Israel did not look intently upon Moses' face because of his glory, although it was passing. Notice, now, the glory, we're going to look at this. But that glory was passing away because something of a greater glory was coming. Keep reading, verse 8. How shall not rather the ministry, the administration, the ministry or the oversight of the Spirit will be glory than 9. For the ministry of condemnation had glory, much rather does the ministry of righteousness exceed. It's a greater glory. Verse 10, this is, for verily that which has been made glorious has not been made glorious in this respect by the reason of the glory that surpasses. Listen, the glory that was in the Old Testament that we look at and we go, wow, that is so amazing. He said, the glory that is belongs here today makes that look like it wasn't even glory.
Oh, wow.
Now, do you understand that significant?
Yes.
Amen.
I mean, we're not talking down against what happened there. It's just what's happening in our day is so much greater. Look at verse 11. Verse 11. For if that which passes away is with glory, much more that which is remaining, that which is here, that which is ours today. And then, of course, verse 18, for we all with an open face beholding the glory of God as in a mirror, and we are transfigured, or changed, is the word transfigured, from glory to glory. Our life is to literally grow from one realm of glory to another realm. It is how we were, it was what we were designed for, and we have lived. The Bible says, for all that sin to come short, we have lived for way too long below or short of the glory of God. Look at 4:1. Therefore, everybody say, therefore.
Therefore.
Seeing we have this ministry. What ministry? The ministry of glory.
Amen.
Even as we obtain mercy, we fail not. Listen, we're going to see this in a second. Going into the Old Testament, but in the Old Testament there were times they couldn't enter because of the glory. The very thing they couldn't enter is the life source of what we minister with. The very thing that it was overpowering and they could not even enter into it, we not only enter it, but we come out of it and in it, and it becomes the very way we minister. It's not just something we talk about, it's something we live in.
Amen.
And that is what is about to take place in our life. We're going to have a restoration of glory. Now go with me to Exodus 40. Okay. Boy, I've got a lot to do here in a few minutes. Exodus 40. But church, this is so important because this is the heart of God. This is what God wants to do in our lives. But in Exodus 40, beginning verse 34, then the cloud covered the tabernacle of meeting, and the glory of the Lord filled the temple. And Moses was what?
Not able.
He was not able. This is what I was talking about. He could not enter the tabernacle of meeting because the glory had taken up an abiding. Had taken up Shekinah. The glory was now Shekinah in there. That's why it would be then called the Shekinah glory, because it was Shekinah. It was there taking up residence. And it had such force and power that out on that side of the cross, he couldn't enter. And the glory of the Lord filled the temple. Look at verse 38. For the cloud of the Lord was above the tabernacle by day, and fire was over it by night, in the sight of all the house of Israel throughout all of their journeys. Now that's Shekinah. It didn't leave. It was with them. When the cloud moved, what did they do? They moved. If the cloud didn't move, they Shekinah. They Shekinah. They just took up residence right there because the glory was there. Real quickly, look, go back into the New Testament. We're going to come right back to Exodus. But I want to show you a couple of scriptures. 1 Thessalonians 2:12. 1 Thessalonians 2:12. You've got to know these. To the end that we should walk worthy of God, who called you, what? Into his kingdom and into his glory. Okay, to say this, I've been called into the kingdom and into the glory. I've been called in. Now look at 2 Thessalonians 2:14. 2 Thessalonians 2:14. For you, brethren, became mediators or imitators of the churches which are in Judea and Christ Jesus. Whereunto he called you. Whereunto he called you through the gospel to the obtaining of the glory. We've not only been called to enter, we've been called to obtain. You see, now look here. He says in one place, he said, I will not give my glory to another. I got a great announcement to you. You're not another.
Amen.
You're his bride.
Hallelujah.
You're his body.
Yes.
You are the same. If you're his body, then you're him.
Right.
So you're not another. You're him. So it's the glory you were called to live in, to be under. Okay. It's going to get good here in a little bit. He's coming back for a glorious bride. Now that I have not He's coming back for a church in the glory. And to understand what it's like to live in the glory. Go with me to Exodus 19. So, are we good for another hour? Exodus 19, begin in verse 9. And the Lord said to Moses, "Behold, I come to you in the thick cloud." Now, pay attention to this. He comes to him in the thick cloud. That, make a note of that. That the people may hear when I speak with you and believe you forever. So Moses told the words of the people to the Lord. And then the Lord said to Moses, well, go to verse 11. I want to skip through. And let them be ready for the third day. For on the third day, the Lord will come down upon Mount Sinai in the sight of the people. Now go down to verse 18. Now Mount Sinai was completely in smoke because the Lord descended upon it in the fire. In smoke, ascending like the smoke of a furnace. And the whole mountain quaked greatly. And when the blast of the trumpet sounded long and became louder, the shofar. And Moses spoke, and God answered him by voice. And the Lord came down upon Mount Sinai at the top of the mountains. And the Lord called Moses up to the mountain, and Moses went up. I just want you to see. I mean, when God comes, he comes shrouded in this thick cloud of his glory. Now go into Exodus 33. Exodus 33, beginning verse 7. I'm moving quickly. I'm taking you to someplace, but I want you to see these. Moses took the tent and pitched it outside the camp, far from the camp, and called it the tabernacle of meeting. And it came to pass that everyone who sought the Lord went out to the tabernacle of meeting, which was outside the camp. And so it was, whenever Moses went out to the tabernacle, all the people rose, and each man stood at his tent door, and watched Moses until he was gone into the tabernacle. It came to pass when Moses entered the tabernacle that the pillar of cloud descended and stood at the door of the tabernacle. And the Lord talked with Moses. And the people saw the pillar of the cloud standing at the tabernacle door. And all the people rose and worshiped each man in their own tent door. So the Lord spoke to Moses. Now pay attention. He spoke to Moses face to face as a man speaks to a friend. And he would return to the camp, but his servant Joshua, don't you love Joshua? The son of Nun was not like that young Monty in Laredo. But Joshua did not depart from the tabernacle. He stayed in the glory. All right? Now go with me to verse 18. And we're moving fast. Then he says, the Lord, show me your glory. Now, I want you to see a picture here of what it's like to be in the glory. It said that God spoke with Moses face to face. Yet he was completely shrouded by this thick cloud. Now, you'll see later, because God's going to say it, but you're not going to see my face because no man can see my face and live. You're like, wait a minute, he's already been face to face, but he was face to face in the thick cloud. He never saw the face. What Moses was asking, and I never saw this before, he said, show me your glory. When he had been so much time in the glory, he was asking, he said, but this time, can I see you? He said, no. Because when I come, I'm going to be there in a thick cloud. I'm going to be there in fire and smoke. I'm going to be there in a way you're going to see what my glory does and what it looks like, but you're not going to see me. You can't see me. But I'll tell you what I will do. I'll let my goodness pass by.
Yeah.
And I'll let you see my goodness.
Yeah.
Okay? Okay, quickly. Let's just look at some of the verses dealing with the Shekinah. Okay. Hey, are y'all with me? Can I go fast?
Yes.
Amen. We'll go fast for a minute. Go with me into Exodus 24:16. Exodus 24:16. Now the glory of the Lord rested on Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it for 6 days. And on the seventh day, he called to Moses out of the midst of the cloud. The sight of the glory of the Lord was like a consuming fire on top of the mountain. And Moses was on the mountain 40 days and 40 nights. But I just want you to see, it rested, it Shekinah. This is one of the first mentions of the word Shekinah. Go with me to 25:8, just the next chapter over. And let them make me a sanctuary that I may dwell. And he is going to dwell. What's going to be there? His glory. When he dwells, anytime you see God dwells, he comes with his glory. And it's expected and intended for his glory to be seen. Look at 29, chapter 29. Go to verses 45 and 46. He says, I will dwell among the children of Israel, and I will be their God. And they shall know that I am the Lord their God, who brought them up out of the land of Egypt. And I will dwell, I will Shekinah with them, and I will be their Lord. And I am the Lord their God. But he is going to Shekinah with them. Okay, I want to take you to one of the most important scriptures you're ever going to see. Go with me to Isaiah 57. Isaiah 57. This to me, highlight this one, underline it, put a star by it, study it, memorize it, all you can. For thus says the high and lofty one, who inhabits, who Shekinahs in eternity, whose name is holy. And he says that I dwell in the high and holy place. Listen, this is God. God is the highest of all of the highest. And he dwells in the highest place. There's nothing above him. He is in the extremely highest place because he in himself is high. He is holy. He is lifted up. So he only dwells. Now get this. He only dwells in the highest of the highest, or in the lowest of the lowest.
Wow.
He'll either dwell in the highest of the highest places, or in those places that are contrite and humble.
Yeah.
One of the things about the glory of God at Azusa, they said most of the time, the glory of God would not be more than a foot off the ground. Which said, if you're going to be in the glory, what would you have to do? You're going to have to prostrate yourself down. You're going to have to get as low as you can possibly get. Because that's what the glory was called. It was called. It said, come down here. Now, there's an awesome scripture in Habakkuk 2:14. And it's a promise that of the knowledge of the glory of God covering the earth as the waters cover the sea.
Yeah.
You know the scripture?
Hold up here.
For the earth shall be filled with the knowledge of the glory of Jehovah as the waters cover the sea. I'd always ask God, what does it mean as the waters cover the sea? I was teaching in Fort Worth, and in the middle of the teaching, the Holy Spirit dropped that revelation into my heart. I began to laugh. Because it was funny to me that right there, I was going one direction, and he just drops this revelation into me. I had to stop my teaching and not tell him what's been going on and what the Lord just said to me. Basically, this is what he said. The way the waters cover the sea or the seabed is the more the seabed, the deeper the water. If there's an island, it rises itself above the glory, it rises itself above the sea, so that it's living as if it is not even aware there is glory, because it's lifting itself up. When you lift yourself up, you become like the island, and you're above the knowledge of the glory of God, because you've got to get low. You can't get high. You can't come in with elevated, you don't come in if you're bringing who you if you don't get love. That's why in services, there will be a mighty move of God. And people will go out saying, wow, did you see that? I saw angels. I saw the glory of God. I mean, in the midst of it all, there will be one or two that said, what? I didn't see anything. There was something going on with it. You know, because if you don't, say this with me, if you don't go low, you won't see the glory of God.
So
And even he would come in, if he saw groups kind of, you know, the different races kind of, he said, no. You can't segregate. Or you can't, you can't segregate. You can't get over your little spread out. Because this, here's the key. Jesus talks about the kingdom of God. He said the kingdom of God is like a field. That you find a treasure in it. You don't just buy the treasure, you buy the field and everything that's in it. You buy the whole package of the kingdom. He said it's like a net. And it casts out, it brings in some every kind of gift, every kind of race, every kind of culture. The thing that was happening in Azusa Street was a picture of the kingdom of God. So if you can't accept the kingdom, you can't accept the glory. You can't have a single race church and have the glory come. The Holy Spirit will permit it. I'm telling you. It's got to be a picture of the kingdom. It's got to be, if you don't have one of every race, be open to any one of your race. I mean, you understand? Okay, but it's not just the race thing. This was before women were really recognized. And yet women were the primary leaders of the congregation. I know my wife would like that. Children, teenagers. I mean, it was just an amazing thing. The second part of it was this thing of going low, the humility. So what would you think if I came in every service? That's what God asked William Seymour to do. He said, I want you to put a block in. And listen, one of the things that was amazing to me, how the people, they not only honored William Seymour, they honored the box. And I love that it said small on it.
Sometime in 1910, William Seymour just stood up on stage, took the box off of his head,
and began to prophesy. In about 100 years, there will be another revival at Azusa Street. Only this time it will not be in one place. It will now be all over the world. There will be a return of the Shekinah glory and the miracles. This revival will not be with just one person or just with pastor. It will be with everyone in the body. This time the revival and the glory will not end until the Lord returns. He repeated that two or three times. 2 days after he first made that proclamation or that prophetic word, Charles Parham on the East Coast, with no communication between them. Remember, this is 1910. I mean, I remember hearing the stories of when Wall Street crashed, that it was weeks before people on the states away even knew anything had happened. So the communication was nothing like what we have today. Charles Parham stands up and makes almost an identical prophetic word. I'm just going to tell you, this is our day. It is our day. And we cannot let this day pass. We cannot allow ourselves in any way to think that we can deserve something by this. There's only one way to receive it. We have to find a way to humble ourselves even more. Because I thought about this. It almost seemed unfair to ask a man like William Seymour. He was already shunned in public. He was already denied access in places. He was already looked upon with disgust. He was already, they knew his name, all of those things. He only had one eye. He was not educated. And yet, they said when he spoke as one who was greatly educated. But to ask someone who was already somewhat, he was a son of a slave, understood what it meant to be low. And yet the Lord said, I want you to go lower. You ready? Want to wear this? I don't know if that's what you mean. I just want to bring you to this place of saying to the Lord, whatever it takes. Whatever you could ask of me. That I could understand that I could have the highest of the highest take up his eternal abode in and around me so that his glory is manifested all around me. And I can, as low as a person as I am, he could use me. I could be a part of something. So I just come to this place with you. We've been on a journey. One of the things that I saw in my dream was that when we started out, we were just walking like this. I saw at the end, I was crawling, and what was my position?
Low.
I was low. In the dream. My face was on the ground and I was apparently making the way to the top. And at the top is a highway of God. At the top is where things happen so freely, where things happen without any effort, without any labor, without having to be. Because all you do is you just discover what it is God wants to do and you release it. When a person walks in and you see they have a need, the excitement level, we get to see another. We get to experience this again. So, are y'all ready?